Hi, my name is Jim Curtis, and I'm the press officer for Global Young Academy, or GYA. One of the most rewarding aspects of my position is that I am able to interact on a daily basis with some of the brightest minds in the young scientific community. Members of the GYA hail from all corners of the globe on six continents and are involved in activities as varied as astrophysics to zoology. Last night, here at our annual general meeting and conference in Pattaya, Thailand, I spoke to somebody who's on the cutting edge of cancer research. Indeed, along those lines, Professor Harald Zur Hausen delivered our keynote address today. He received his Nobel Prize for his work in cancer prevention, for which he developed a vaccine that's been in use for 10 years now. To say that he's saved thousands of lives is not an exaggeration. Dr. Zur Hausen is kind enough to join us now to answer a few questions. Dr. Zur Hausen, thank you for joining us today.
Pleasure.
During your presentation today, your keynote address, you mentioned that an extended length of breastfeeding is very effective in suppressing cancer.
Well, of certain cancers, not all cancers.
Mm-hmm. At what length of time would you recommend or do you think is appropriate for women to breastfeed? Like 12 months, 24 months, 36?
Let's say it this way. First of all, for infections, some infections are prevented by breastfeeding.
Right.
It's probably advisable at least to breastfeed for 6 months. As far as cancer is concerned, the situation is probably the same, although it might, a prolonged period of breastfeeding might be even advantageous. There are very few cancers, as far as the babies are concerned, where there's some evidence that breastfeeding protects against them. That's primarily acute lymphatic leukemia. It's to some degree Hodgkin's disease, neuroblastomas, and that's almost it, besides a neurological disease, multiple sclerosis, where also some evidence exists.
Mm. And during the time when the weaning process occurs, you studied the meat from cows and the dairy from cows. Is it true that other types of meat would be best to be avoided during that time?
It's very hard to say at this moment. The only thing we do know is that our common dairy beef, the type of Eurasian type of dairy cattle, that contains some agents which can infect humans or can be transmitted to humans and which may have a negative effect, at least after very long periods of time.
Mm.
And that's the interesting part. It presumably takes between 4 and 7 decades before something may happen, and in some instances nothing may happen at all.
Right. So it's a gamble.
Well, it's a gamble in the sense that these kinds of infections do induce some kind of mutations in the neighboring tissues, and that these mutations, particularly if they occur in proliferating cells, that they're fixed there as a genetic modification.
Mm.
And in some instances, it leads to a deletion of the gene function or to a modification of the gene function. If these are genes which basically control somehow cell growth and cell proliferation, and if they are hit, then something dangerous may happen.
Yeah,
they convert into premalignant lesions and later on, even with more mutations, into malignant ones.
Do you eat beef?
I eat beef, yes, because I know I'm infected anyway. And in my age, at the tender age of 82, it doesn't matter anymore.
Right. You also mentioned during the presentation that there was another way to avoid the possibility of the infections that lead to cancer, and that was aspirin and ibuprofen intake. One of my colleagues said, great, should I run out to the pharmacy and start taking aspirin already? Could you expand on that?
Well, he should do it only under medical control. I mean, aspirin, of course, has some side effects if you take it for a prolonged period of time. Some people develop allergies against aspirin, and in other cases, it facilitates bleeding, in certain instances. So usually these are low doses of aspirin, which are taken daily for a prolonged period of time. And it's known since quite a long time, in fact, that aspirin, ibuprofen, and also what is called a COX-2 inhibitor substances, they all have the same effect. They have some protective effect against certain types of human cancers. And that is in itself quite interesting,
yes,
because these are all anti-inflammatory drugs. They block inflammations and obviously small inflammations. And that is the indeed one aspect which we investigate. These small inflammations are the reason for producing, first of all, induced by specific triggers, by specific agents. And apparently these inflammations subsequently lead in cells which proliferate to such modifications, or may lead to such modifications which eventually turn out to be cancer.
Thank you. You mentioned that you're at the tender young age of 82, but here we are in our annual general meeting of the Global Young Academy. Do you have any advice that you might impart to researchers starting out on their career these days?
Well, it's usually hard to say. I mean, I'm often asked this question. The point is really, from my viewpoint, that you have to, first of all, select a topic which is promising. That's very important. And the second one is to be a little bit stubborn in continuing to work on it for a long period of time. And the third point might be not to listen too carefully to your peers, because sometimes they ridicule your work in spite of the fact that it might be quite worthwhile to follow it up. I had the experience previously with papillomaviruses and human cancer because at that time people told me, particularly some epidemiologists, that everyone knows that papillomavirus is causing warts and warts are harmless. And of course you have to differentiate. Some are indeed harmless, but some are not. And here, with those agents with which we are working presently, we most likely deal with a similar situation, that we have some of them which are relatively harmless and others which cause chronic inflammatory lesions which eventually have deleterious effects.
One last question. My understanding of your research, of course, is limited, but it seems that the finding has to deal primarily with females. Are there any aspects of this that are applicable to males?
Well, first of all previous work on papillomavirus is clearly applicable to males because these agents, at least those which cause cervical cancer, they are mainly transmitted by males to females. That's to protect your partner. That's already an important point. The second one is that there exist some cancers, like cancer of the oropharynx and also of the anal region, which occur in males in most regions more frequently than in females, and they're due to the same agents as cancer of the cervix. So that is one of the reasons. But there's also something which we need to convey to the public, namely that males need to be vaccinated as early as females in order, first of all, to protect them and then to protect yourself against those types of cancer. And this is very difficult to persuade, it's very difficult to persuade ministries, health ministries, the people working in public health, and even some physicians, that is important for males, which obviously males don't get cervical cancer.
Right.
But nevertheless, there are other reasons.
All right. Well, thank you again for
your time.
I appreciate you spending time answering these questions. And thank you again for delivering the keynote address here in Pattaya at our annual general meeting of the Global Young Academy.
Well, thank you.